So, hello again. Today I'll be telling you about the Shelf Inspector, which is an ongoing project in the data centrics that we have. We focus on solving some retail problems using computer vision techniques. And before I begin, let me thank to the organizers. It's a really great atmosphere here. It's a really nice place. And okay. No, seriously, I'm really thankful that I have this opportunity to share this with you. Okay, so for now, imagine that you're standing in a supermarket, such as Albert, Billa, Tesco, and so on, and you're looking at this shelf filled with energy drinks. What's important to note here is usually these products are not displayed there just randomly, but there is some pre-specified planogram which states what should be where and how many pieces and so on. And brands like Red Bull, they pay a huge deal of money in order to secure the best positions in the shelf so you can like see them clearly when you visit the shelf, and to have as much as big shelf share as possible in relative to their competitors. So they actually implement some mechanisms in order to check whether the situation in the supermarkets across the country is what they pay for. So basically during the day, some people come, they see the shelf like this, and they buy some products and they leave it in a state like this when there are like empty spaces. And sometimes later, the guy who works as a merchandiser comes, and his job is the following. He has to refill the shelf with another product, and also in some cases, if the retailer pays for it, he has the obligations to actually count the amount of products that were there on the shelf the time he came to the shelf, and report the situation to the retailer so he can actually do some compliance with the planogram analysis. So what we thought, we could like make this process more effective and less error prone with using just by making this guy take an image of the shelf and then use some computer vision techniques to detect all of these products and do the compliance with the planogram automatically. So this brings me to the Shelf Inspector, which basically has quite a lot of goals regarding the situation in retail. And some of these would be making the retailer actually able to effectivize the work of the merchandisers. So basically when the merchandiser often comes and reports that the shelf was empty, maybe the merchandiser should consider increasing the frequency with which the merchandisers visit the shelves. And also he can monitor the situation across different supermarkets, and also there's some price monitoring component and the reporting tool and so on. But to me personally, the most important part is where I build the model that detects these objects, and I hope this will be interesting to you guys as well. So this is what my presentation will be about. So basically when we began in the early days of the project, we had to have some results really fast. So we use this AutoML trained networks provided by Google, which basically are trained to detect some common objects such as humans, cars, books, and so on. And we found out that if you decrease the confidence level, the confidence threshold low enough, it basically detects everything in your image that could be something potentially. So then we had these object proposals and we fine-tuned the Inception V3 network to basically classify if the proposed object is a Red Bull, a Big Shock, or anything. And yeah, we had some results. We weren't so satisfied with them because the accuracy was obviously not so high. So we later like enhanced this model with the template matching technique. So we had some templates for each of these products we were interested in, and then we covered also a few of the false negatives and increased our accuracy. But still, like, we felt we were not going in the correct direction, and the potential clients were still interested in this. So we basically had some other images labeled, and we trained completely the masker CNN model for object detection, which showed up that it works quite nicely. And we only later enhanced it with the XGBoost model to actually make it able to even distinguish between objects that look similarly but are of different size. And I will mention that later down in the presentation as well. So Now, MuskRCNN, the Musk Regional Convolutional Neural Network, may I ask how many of you guys have ever heard of this model? Okay, so I see some hands. And those of you who heard of it, have you actually used it in some kind of project? Okay, so some. Okay, so I guess my presentation will be then in quite informative for you, so that's nice. So basically, well, I cannot see the whole image here. It's quite a shame. It doesn't matter, I will just describe what's meant to be there. Okay, so the MuskRCNN model, which was introduced in 2017, which is about 3 years now, and it's still a relevant model. It's quite nice. Well, its main focus, the main task that the model solves is actually the object detection with masks. So I can not only tell where the object is in the image, but also tell which pixels exactly belong to our target objects and which do not. Here, what you can see in the top right corner of the screen is the number A is the image classification task. Basically, this is a very common task in computer vision. If you have model suitable for this task, it can tell you that what can you generally see in the image, if it's a cube, if it's a bottle, and so on, and perhaps with what confidence, but not where the object actually is. This is the task that solves the models for object localization, which you can see in the topmost and rightmost corner, and you get a rough idea where these objects are with these rectangular boxes. What was meant to be here is exactly finding the object masks. So I can not only tell you on the level of rectangular bounding boxes, but on the level of individual pixels. So basically, MuskRCNN, which belongs to the stream of literature that goes from RCNN, FastRCNN, FastRCNN, and now MuskRCNN, has a special branch for it. If you want to try to solve one of these problems for yourself, guys, I recommend this nice implementation by Matterport, which is written in TensorFlow 1. And we used this as a starting point and only did some minor adaptations to our case. So it worked quite nicely. And as a side note, I would like to mention this Cascade Mask RCNN. So if you look up the COCO test dev dataset, which is a common computer vision benchmarking dataset, and you look up the object detection task, you will see that this Cascade MuskRCNN, which is basically a MuskRCNN model with some boosted backbone, is currently still ranked one. So, yeah, this kind of architecture still rolls. So, yeah, just give us a second, please. Jo, nevidím ty obrázky vůbec. Pustíš to, že tak od sebe. Teď to pustíme z jiného počítače, uvidíme. Yes, I have Windows. Okay. Thanks for pointing that out. Okay, and we are back with the Mac. Perfect. Okay, so this is what I was talking about. Okay. And the pointer? Don't worry. Ah, awesome. So basically, this is a MuskRCNN from a, say, bird's perspective. And what I would like to do now is to guide you through the individual components to basically give you a little bit of intuition about how it works, because I think this is useful for the situation when you will be deciding if this model architecture might be useful for your case or not. Or at least it was for me. So basically the first component would be the convolutional backbone. Here down in the bottom of the picture, you see an image, which is like the image with the shelf you've seen previously, which was resized into some fixed spatial dimensions and you feed it to some deep neural network. In principle, I think you could use any network at this point. The goal is to extract high quality semantics features. So if it's either a VGG or something, yeah, it could be. In history, all of these ResNets and ResNects were used. And what we used as it was used in the original paper was the ResNet with feature pyramid network. And just very briefly, the network looks like this feature pyramid network. When you take the ResNet 101 and you cut it into several segments, and each of these segments outputs some feature maps of different sizes. It gets smaller as you go up in the pyramid, but the features are supposed to be higher quality. What's then done in this top-down part of the pyramid is that you upsample these high-quality small-size features into a bigger size, and you add them back to the respective outputs of these pyramid segments, and then you output some combined feature maps, which should work nice. And then you have these feature maps, and you move into the another component, which is the region proposal network, which is pretty important as it serves for pointing you towards the places on your feature maps where your target objects should basically lie. And it's done in the following fashion. You have some anchor boxes, which are windows of some specified aspect ratios and sizes, and you slide them over your feature maps, which you had previously from the feature pyramid. And at each position, you have a classifier which determines whether this anchor box contains your target object or not. And if the probability of having a target object in this particular anchor box is high, you remember this position and anchor box. And once you do it for all anchor boxes and for all feature maps, you just set some threshold and take the most probable ones which should contain the objects and call this your regions of interest. And these are like rectangle-shaped feature maps. Okay, and the another one, which is a region of interest alignment layer, a new element to the masker CNN. Now, basically, the goal is to take your rectangular proposals and to resize them into fixed-size squares. So basically, it's done in the following fashion. You set some dimensions, say like 14 times number of channels, and then you lay a square grid over your anchor. And for the square grid, you want to get single value for each cell of this grid. So you sample some points in there, and you get value for these points using a bilinear interpolation and a max pooling to get a single value. So after you're done, you have resized all of your regions of interest into squares. And you move to the last stage, which are the masker CNN head branches. There are actually three. The first one is a bounding box regression branch, and its purpose is to refine the position of your target object within the region of interest. And then there is this classification branch, which is perhaps the most important one. It has a softmax layer, and it does a classification of the region of interest. So you can tell whether it's object A, B, or whether it's a background. And then in parallel goes the mask branch, which has a sigmoid for each pixel in the region of interest, and you're able to classify whether each of these pixels belong to the object or not. And it's interesting because it goes in parallel. So at this point, you have to do this mask prediction for each of these classes. So these classes do not compete between themselves at this point. And the final mask is determined based on the result of classification branch. This is how the architecture looks like. These bounding box regression and classification branches share some fully connected layers. Okay. So, regarding the model training, here are some formulas, but yeah, doesn't matter. So you have some multiple losses. You have a log loss for the classification branch. You have bounding box For the bounding box regression, you use some L1 smooth function, doesn't matter. And for the mask branch, you use this averaged binary cross entropy. And what's interesting here is that you can place different weights to each branch. So if you're interested more about classification, you put some bigger weights here. And then you will have to be satisfied with the lower quality masks, but that's okay in some applications. So basically, back to our case, we utilized Masker CNN for several tasks. Firstly, we did the object detection, which is detecting the products themselves, the most important one. Then we also used it for detection of the edges, of the shelf edges, which are important for the planogram compliance computation. We also used it for detection of the price tags in the images. And we have also used it, finally, for detection of the figures in the price tags. Well, to me, this is quite funny, because when I look back, I remember that we had this nice mask RCNN model, which worked nicely on detection of the products. But for the other cases, I thought there has to be a simpler solution, which would not require so many labels. But yeah, for example, for the edge detection, we use the Kenny edge detector into Hugh Lines algorithm. And for the price figures detection, we use the Tesseract OCR and some other ideas. But after having tried Mask RCNN also for these cases, its precision and the results were so good that we just had to stick with it. And yeah, often I get this question, whether we use a single model for all of these classes, or if we just put, for all of these tasks, or if we just put all these classes into a single model and train it once. Well, the answer is that we have a separate models for these tasks, and the reason is, there are two reasons, actually. The first one is that we use different training regime for each of these tasks. For example, the objects, when we train the objects, we use different set of augmentations than when we train the edges. And the second one is more practical. In case we wanted to put everything into one model, we would have to label everything everywhere. And this is something that we do not want to do, because getting these labels can be quite expensive. So we have separate data sets for all of these tasks. So yeah, basically these are our main data sets that we work with in the Shelf Inspector project. The main one is about the energy drinks in the shelf. And currently, we have about 300 fully labeled, fully annotated images with the segments. We have about 50 another annotated for testing and validation. And we try to predict 92 different classes. It's quite dark here, but still, I can see that those who have ever trained some deep networks on images are probably looking at me right now and thinking, like, is this guy serious, 300 images? And the answer is, sort of. Okay, so the reason why it might work is that these images are quite information rich. On average, we have like 120 objects on one image. And the other reason is that these objects, like the task is not so hard. These objects look quite similar to each other from image to image. If I take, for example, this classic Red Bull, and I look at it on different image, it can be taken from a different angle, it can be under different lighting, and it can be slightly rotated. But the logo is the same, the color contrasts are the same. So yeah, you kind of want to overfit slightly. Yeah, the other case is the Red Bull drinks in a fridge. These are usually located at some petrol stations and so on. And for this, we have like 130 another annotated images, another 30 for testing, and we try to predict about six different classes, which are a subset of these 92. And another data set that we are currently collecting more images for is the Nestlé coffee data set, the Nescafé coffees. And currently, we have about 200 annotated images. Yeah. So basically, the techniques that we have used and that sort of worked for us. The first one, of course, the transfer learning. Without having used the transfer learning, I think we wouldn't be able to train anything on such low amount of images. So basically, when you do the transfer learning, you use some database like ImageNet or Coco from Microsoft, which has already been mentioned here today. These contain like hundreds of thousands of images and even millions. And you train your network on these images. And after you're done, you take these weights and use them to initialize your network and fine tune it on your data set just for a couple of epochs. And yeah, it quite works. What we have also used were the augmentations in the training and also in the testing. So basically, whenever we want to do the predictions in the production, we take the image, we augment it, we like flip it horizontally, vertically, we rotate it, or you've seen some other types of augmentations by the guys before me. And this is what we do, and we do the predictions for each of these images, then we de-augment these predictions and combine them. And yeah, this gave us like 2.6 of another mean average precision percentage points. Another technique that we used was the image editing. We basically, as you can see in this example, we tried to upsample some classes which are especially interesting to us and for which we wanted to achieve a higher precision. So we took some other products from different images and placed them there, here, in some blank spaces. And this gave us another 2.6 mean average precision. I think this was like 2.3 and this is 2.6. And what we also did sometimes was the instant switching. So we like confused the model with the neighboring products. For example, we took like this Red Bull and switched it with the red one and so on. Next thing, we noticed that because of this fixed size of regions of interest, the mask RCNN basically has no way to determine if the object looks the same and has different size, which object it is. For example, if you take this classic Red Bull with 255 milliliters and you compare it to this Red Bull of like 370 something milliliters, in the region of interest, they look the same. So something else had to be used. We basically noticed that in every image, there are some reference objects like this yellow tropical Red Bull, which come with only one size. So we computed features like this. We took the prediction boxes for each of these products, and we computed the relative widths and the relative heights in respect to the reference products. And we fed it to some classifier. You can use basically anything. We use XGBoost, and it worked. OK, before I move finally to our results, scores, I want to shortly talk about the metric that we used for evaluation. Basically, when you do the object detection, you not only want to focus on classification. For that, the precisions and recalls are used, but you also want to use you also want to somehow penalize if the model does not locate your objects well. For that, you use this IOU, which means intersection over union ratio. And basically, you set some threshold, let's say 50-50. So if the IOU is about 50%, you regard this particular prediction as a correct one. If it's below, it's not positive. It's not correct prediction. So then you want to construct this precision recall curve. And to explain it on an example, imagine that across my data set, I have 100 of different products of a certain class. And basically, let's say I want to find the value, like here on the axis are precision, and on the axis, on the x-axis is a recall. So I want to find the value of precision for recall of 60%. So I take my predictions of this particular class, I sort them by the confidence, from the most confident one to the least confident one, and I look to the point where I'm able to correctly predict 60 of these 100 cans which are actually there. And if it has taken me only 60 predictions so far, my precision will be 100. If it has taken me twice as much, say 120 different cans, I will have precision of 0.5. So like this, you can basically compute the precision for each of your recalls. And in practice, what's usually done is that you interpolate this curve and make it only a non-increasing function. So in the last step, you have, it's important to remember that you have this curve for each class separately and for each IOU level separately. So if you compute the area under this curve, and then you average it over your classes, you have what's called an average precision for your IOU level, let's say IOU 50. And then if you look at this, all these different IOU levels from 50% to 95%, and then you average your average precision over these, then you get the mean average precision. And that's what is usually used. Okay, so I cannot see the value, so I will tell you to them. Oh, well, that's weird. Okay, so for this first case of energy drinks in the shelf, we achieved at the level of 50 about 92% of average precision, which goes down to like 65% at mean average precision, which basically means we are able to find most of the products and classify them well. But for like high thresholds of IOU, we don't predict perfect masks. So that's it. But it doesn't hurt us so much. For the Red Bull drinks in fridge, we get almost perfect precisions for the lower IOU levels. We get about 99 or 98% at IOU levels 75, which is quite nice. And for the Nestlé coffee shelf, we currently have about 80% of mean average precision at IOU level 50. So we need to work on that a little bit more. And that's all from me. So thank you. And I'll be happy to answer your questions.
Thank you. Thank you, Marek. Before we go for the questions from the Slido, are there any questions from the audience? Yeah.
Thank you very much for interesting talk. I have actually three quick questions.
Perfect.
First one, when I played with region proposal networks, I find out that pretty much important is the resolution of the images. So have you had some issues with this, or was it just okay? This is first. I will ask all the questions and then you can answer. The second one is about the anchors which are in a region proposal network. Have you thought about, for example, YOLO 9000, where they do you know the paper about YOLO? Architecture which is called YOLO, YOLO 9000.
Yeah, I know about the network, I've not read the paper.
They actually had some interesting ideas about how to pick the anchors, because Ross Gerschik used some like symmetric anchors covering a whole image. And the YOLO paper, which I recommend to read actually, they have some neat tricks, and one of them was just really improve which anchors use where. So they did evolution on this part of the problem. And the last question was about the backbone engine. When you talk about convolution neural networks, recently there appeared some automatically generated, like NASNet, for example, and they outperformed results also in object detection and all other parts of image processing. Have you thought about using those state-of-the-art backbones and maybe improve?
Okay, thank you. So to the first question regarding the resolution, yes, what we currently use is 1024 times 1024, and we have played with it. Yes, so for example, for the price tags, so when we have the price tags and we want to detect the figures in the price tag, of course we do not need to use such high resolution, so we like decreased it. And for some other, not here, but for some other project, when we are especially interested in predicting very small objects, we naturally increase the resolution. So yeah, we kind of play with it. But for these type of images, we found that 1024 works quite nicely. Okay, to the other question, some clever designs of anchor boxes. Yeah, I think it all falls down to what objects are you looking for. If it's like buses which are longer than the shape. So basically, if it's something that's long and not very of high height, then you would use this certain aspect ratio, but we are what we are looking are cans which are almost like circle or sometimes a rectangle which is more high than wide, and I think all of those aspect ratios are there in the code that we use. I've checked that. So yeah, we use basically what was implemented there. We have not used the tricks from the YOLO. And regarding the last question, yes, we have thought about it. And especially what I would love to do is the Cascade Masker CNN, which basically uses not only one ResNet, but three ResNet 101, which share the features between themselves. So this, I think, is a really nice idea, and it has proven to work really nicely. Well, the neural architecture search, I think to find a perfect network which would work for like at this size, at this scale, it would be pretty expensive neural architecture search. So what could you do is the efficient net, if you've seen the paper. So
yes.
Yeah, you could do like you could look for effective architecture and then scale it up. So yeah, that's something that could be done, but I have not seen a paper that would beat the Cascade so far. So
really?
Yeah.
Interesting. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. You're welcome. Another questions?
Just a small addition to the first question. Have you considered trying even other backbones, such as, for example, VGG? Because some of the actual talk we had reported that for object detection using a very old network, VGG, they get better result on object detections, and the switch of the backbone is basically for free. So.
Okay. So what we have tried was the ResNet 50 without the feature pyramid, and this ResNet 101 with the feature pyramid. And it shows that it works better with the ResNet with the feature pyramid, but we have not used the VGG, so I don't know. But like the intuition is, like the bigger network would could get the higher quality feature maps, but I don't know. It's interesting. Maybe someone would prove me wrong.
Any other question? Oh, I will also have one question.
Okay.
Why did you go for mask RCNN? Why isn't simple object detection with bounding boxes enough?
Okay, yeah, that's something that we often talk about. Okay, so what I know is that mask RCNN at the time when we were deciding about the architecture is generally performing well in the object detection task. So yeah, it was our first choice. Even though we do not necessarily need the masks at this point, we still are thinking that it could be useful in the upcoming months, maybe when we will more analyze the spaces that are left actually in the shelf. So the bounding boxes will not be enough. Perhaps we will need the exact masks. So we are kind of preparing for that by having labeled this data set. Yeah, so did I answer your question?
Yes. I was also considering the labeling, because to label bounding boxes is very simple, but if you need to do masks, it's
of course
different.
That's true. But well, most of our objects are almost perfect rectangles. These are the cans. So only you need like a few clicks and it's done. So it's not so much harder than labeling a bounding box, you know. And yeah, if it's perhaps maybe if the can is like partly lying, so you get it right. You don't get some mess into your bounding box, which is nice.
Okay, thank you. And two more questions in Slido. Did you try to tackle the problem with image processing techniques?
Well, to me, these are image processing techniques. as I said, we tried the template matching. And it didn't work well enough. It simply took so much time, because we would want to do the correlation with so many templates, it would just not be worth it. So at the end, we opted for the deep neural network.
Okay. And did you deal with object occlusions?
Yeah, and maybe a little bit what I would like to add to the first question. Our experience with like classical computer vision techniques are that you have to play with these thresholds all day long. And we would never find a perfect threshold that would be sufficient for all the images in our data set. So we almost, when we start with a new problem, we are thinking of computer vision techniques without training. But then after days of setting the threshold, we just go always back to the deep networks. Okay, did you deal with the object occlusions? Well, yeah, of course, these objects occlude, but basically we have a rule. If the object is like visible well, we label it, and the masker CNN can find the object that even though it's occluded, if a good part of it is visible. So that's it.
Okay, one more question. Is it possible to get presentation? Okay, yeah.
Yeah, I hope.
There will be the video on YouTube on our channel. But if you can,
of course, yes,
share the slides with us, we will also
be
share
happy
it with you.
So if you have many more questions, I'll be around here, so you can ask me.
Okay, thank you very much.